There are a few seats in the front also. Please do come and occupy the front seats if you like. Can everyone take a seat so that we can get started? Kindly take your seats. Good evening to all of you. My name is Dr. Raghottam. On behalf of Manthana Bengaluru, it gives me great pleasure to welcome every one of you to today's lecture program. Manthana is an intellectual platform where we bring thought leaders to share their insights with us on important topics for the country. And in that spirit, we have arranged today's program, which is on Pujaniya Shri Guruji Golwalkar, who, as many of you will know, is the second Sarsangha Chalak of Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. He was a spiritual sadhaka who chose to dedicate his life for in service of Bharat Mata. And to talk about Shri Guruji, we have none other than Manya Shri Gurumurthy Ji, who has come all the way from Chennai. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome him also, in particular, to this program. So we will get started right away. May I now request Dr. Giridhar Upadhyaya, President of Manthana, to accompany Shri Gurumurthy Ji to the stage. Although Shri Gurumurthy Ji perhaps needs no introduction, especially to this audience, it's still appropriate that we introduce him formally. And to do the introduction, we have Shri Prasanna Kosigi, who is a Manthana Karyakarta, and he is also an IT professional, currently works for Cognizant.
Hari Om, Ellarigu Namaskara. Distinguished dignitaries, ಮಾತಾ ಭಗಿನಿ, ಆತ್ಮೀಯ ಬಂಧುಗಳೇ, ಸಜ್ಜನರೇ, ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಸುಸ್ವಾಗತ. ಆನ್ ಬಿಹಾಫ್ ಆಫ್ ಮಂಥನಾ ಟೀಮ್, ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಮೈ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಪ್ಲೆಷರ್ ಇನ್ ವೆಲ್ಕಮಿಂಗ್ ಈಚ್ ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ಯು ಟು ದಿಸ್ ಆಗಸ್ಟ್ ಗ್ಯಾದರಿಂಗ್. ಐ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲಿ ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್ ಅವರ್ ಫ್ರೆಂಡ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಮೀಡಿಯಾ ಗ್ರೂಪ್ಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ಜಾಯಿನಿಂಗ್ ಅಸ್ ಟುಡೇ. ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಆನ್ ದ ಡಯಾಸ್, ಆನ್ ದ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಮ್ ಲೆಫ್ಟ್, ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಗಿರಿಧರ ಉಪಾಧ್ಯಾಯ, President of this forum, Manthana. He is also managing committee member of the Mythic Society. He is currently working as associate professor consultant microbiologist at 8 reputed hospitals and labs in Bengaluru. He is a RSS Swayamsevak since last 35 years and also Pranta Prachara Vibhag Toli member. Welcome, Giridharji. I consider this a great privilege to introduce India's well-known economist and a highly respected and sought-after personality and today's chief guest and speaker, Sri Swaminathan Gurumurthy Ji. A versatile personality who is a chartered accountant by profession, journalist by passion, political commentator and thought leader, philosopher of economics and dharma, keen student of law, a visiting faculty at IITs, research professor and of legal anthropology at Shastra University. He was an honorary invitee by Tumakuru University as a distinguished professor to guide their research faculty on economic issues. He is one of the well-known exponents of Swadeshi movement, which has reappeared 5 decades after Bharat attained freedom in the face of a sudden onset of uncalibrated globalization. Sri Gurumurthy's journalistic journey began at a very young age when he met the formidable Sri Ramnath Goenka at the Indian Express. His association with the Indian Express and the newspaper's campaign against corporate misdeeds and corruption at high places brought out the investigative journalist hidden in him. He was consecutively rated amongst the most powerful personalities in India by several magazines, including Business Baron and India Today. With his erudite and thought-provoking columns, he has captivated the readers of leading newspapers like the New Indian Express and the Hindu Business Line. Recently, he has taken over the role of editor of an iconic politico-cultural magazine called Tughlaq, in continuation of the legacy left behind by late Sri Cho Ramaswamy. Gurumurthyji is also a pioneer in setting up a common platform for Hindu spiritual and seva organizations who have been silently doing yeoman service to the society in their respective fields. The Hindu Spiritual and Service Fair HSSF has started off in Chennai, twice successfully held in Bengaluru, and has gone all the way up to northeastern Bharat and attained popularity among the youth. Gurumurthyji is a very active Twitterati whom we admire and follow. Today, we are delighted to hear him on a topic, Sri Guruji Golwalkar and Contemporary India. Pujaniya Sri Madhava Sadashiva Golwalkar, fondly known as Guruji, was the second Sarasanghachalak of Rashtriya Swayamsevaka Sangha. Sri Guruji, a name that resonates in the hearts of millions of Swayamsevaks and their families with memories of limitless sattvic love and affection, and a courageous personality that is full of enduring tranquility. Sri Gurumurthyji has written an elaborate and scholarly introduction to a book titled Sri Guruji Reminiscences, compiled by our Jyeshtha Shrestha Sangha Pracharak Mananiya late Sri Kru Suryanarayan Ropji. This book has been a true inspiration for many new generations of Swayamsevaks and Karyakartas. We are deeply honored to welcome you, sir, Sri Gurumurthyji.
Thank you, Prasanna. So without further ado, Sri Gurumurthyji.
Namaskarams to all. When Raghottam asked me to speak on Sri Guruji, I thought I may not be mentally alive to do this because I have already done 3 public meetings today. I thought for a topic like this, one has to be fresh. One has to have had a lot of contemplation. But the kind of topics I had to deal with since morning had nothing to do with the kind of noble task I have to do now. So I was not very keen to accept this program. But there was no other way I could have devoted another day, for the simple reason that, like many things that happened in my life, in which I have never been a party, I was made to become the editor of the Tughlaq magazine after Mr. Cho Ramaswamy passed away, on the pain of its being closed down if I did not accept it. So destiny has guided my life all through, and so a 24/7 schedule has been added to my already existing schedule, so you can understand the kind of pressure under which I am operating. So I may not be really doing my best today, because this topic deserves a much fresh and a much more freer time schedule, which I did not have since morning. You know, when I studied Guruji Golwalkar, I first ceased to be a swayamsevak bearing reverence for him. You know, if you revere a person, you cannot analyze that person. So reverence is the ultimate position in which you keep somebody. For example, I revere the Kanchi Mahaswami. I cannot analyze him. In fact, you revere a person only when you cannot analyze him. You accept him. But Guruji was not simply Guruji, and he was no Guruji at all. In fact, the name Guruji was a misnomer. Nobody actually regarded him as Guruji. It is his students in the Banaras Hindu University who called him Guruji. Afterwards, his name became Guruji. The status of Golwalkar was not Guruji. We must understand that. This is one of the most important distinctions in RSS. That the Guru is the flag and not the man. But many people thought Guruji was the Guruji of RSS. It was because of the word Guruji becoming a misnomer. And so unless you exorcise yourself of the fact that you are going to analyze Sri Golwalkar as a personality, as a leader, as a man, as a philosopher, as an organizer, as a man with a foresight, as a man who transcended the compulsions and of the context. He was not arrested by the context. He transcended the context. He had a helicopter view. If you have to analyze a person like that, the first thing that you should do is, you should not revere him. You should begin analyzing him. It is in this spirit I will try to present Sri Golwalkar. Because Golwalkar's, the people who have experienced Golwalkar are essentially the RSS workers. His field has been the domain of RSS. Of course, very keen personalities outside have perceived Golwalkar, analyzed him, written about him, critiqued him, praised him. But still, no study of either Guruji, Golwalkar or the RSS is complete. It has not even begun. In fact, when I began writing about, instead I am halfway through writing a book on Golwalkar. The introduction which was referred to, which I wrote at the instance of Mananiya Sri Shurnarayan Rao, who shaped me as what I am today, gave me basics of nationalism, patriotism, courage, confidence. When he wrote a book on the reminiscences of Sri Guruji, he asked me to write an introductory preface. That is where I first began studying Golwalkar. And when I started studying him, I felt that what I knew about him was nothing. Not that I have not studied him completely, my study is still on. The more I study, the more I am mining, the more I am getting the kind of perception about him, which I could not get for the last 30-35 years of my association with the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. I am still mining Sri Golwalkar. You cannot really distinguish between the RSS and Golwalkar because the philosophy of RSS is working methods, its discipline and character, its training models, its public image have all aligned with Golwalkar. The acceptability of the RSS and the acceptability of Golwalkar couldn't be separate. RSS is perhaps the most admired and equally detested organization in India in the last several decades. And so is Golwalkar. How is it that such great people have been greatly admired on the one side and equally detested on the other? This is an area for discussion. This is an area for debate. This is an area for understanding the psychology of the nation, its capacity to perceive people. These are all issues which came to my mind when I began working on the total personality of Sri Golwalkar. In the same way, he was either understood or misunderstood, appreciated or critiqued. You know, unless you transcend both appreciation as well as criticism, you cannot get the total personality of a great philosopher and a thinker who had a vision not only for his motherland, he had a vision for the world. Many people arrest him and quarantine him and fix him to India. That is also not correct. See the kind of people who admired the RSS. When I went through the list of people who admired the RSS and the people who detested the RSS and what they said about the RSS, I found RSS is perhaps the most socially admired organization in India and equally politically detested organization. So it's a socially admired organization and politically detested organization. So the political discourse was never comforting to RSS, never fair to the RSS, were never reasonable to the RSS. In the same way, it was never fair or reasonable or comforting to Golwalkar also. The kind of people who admired the RSS were very important social personalities. Mahatma Gandhi, Sardar Patel, Bharat Ratna Bhagwan Das, General Kariyappa, Zakir Hussain, Jayaprakash Narayan, Ambedkar, Kushwant Singh, Dr. Radhakrishnan. Great social leaders. Why social leaders could appreciate the RSS, understand it and view it favorably? It because they had no political stakes. It is political stakes that made people detest RSS. So RSS had an impact on politics. Politics did not have an impact on the RSS. RSS had an impact on politics. Actually, Guruji, Golwalkar cannot be analyzed without analyzing the RSS. As I said, the personalities of both are aligned, mixed up, inseparably, because for 33 years he guided the RSS in the most critical times for the RSS, for the nation, for the Hindu philosophy, for the Hindus. I don't think anyone could have faced the kind of problems he had had to face. And so there was virtually no distinction between the two. He shaped the RSS. He presented the RSS to the country. And probably built it brick by brick for 33 years. The most important point with which I will start is the fact, it is an admission by a very, very well-known Marxist scholar. That is how I will start with how the entire discourse on RSS is based on total illiteracy about RSS. You know, before you critique somebody, you must study somebody much more than when you want to praise somebody. Unless you are very clear that a person is wrong, you will never say a person is wrong. you must study the other side and then critique the other side. This is called Purvapaksha. This is the Indian model of criticism. You never criticize any thought or any person, any religion, any philosophy without studying it. So studying the other viewpoint is the first qualification to make a comment, particularly if it is criticism. You only see criticism about RSS, abuse about RSS, hanging the RSS, and everything is applicable to Golwalkar also. You only see it. You will be stunned to know Dr. Achin Vanayak, one of the most important scholars of the left establishment, made a big confession in the year 1995 that the RSS has not been studied in depth by anybody. It's an open admission that no one has studied the RSS. There is only one book about RSS which has been written by Walter Anderson and one more person, Domley. That is the only book available, and there is no other study of RSS. But still you will criticize RSS, abuse RSS, castigate RSS without studying it. This is a very major starting point to understand how the RSS has been, or Guruji has been, unfairly commented upon. And so we must view these negative comments, these critiques and criticisms and abuses, with a question that none of them is based on an in-depth study of RSS or Guruji. This is the most important point which people have to stress. If you have to critique someone, if you have to study him or the philosophy, and if you have not studied it, you are disabled or disqualified from commenting or critiquing the person or the philosophy. So the entire criticism of Golwalkar, and incidentally of the RSS, is based on an inherent disqualification that there has been no study at all. In the last 6-8 months, I have been studying. The RSS was born in 1925, and Sri Golwalkar assumed the responsibility as the Sarsangachalaka of RSS in the year 1939-40. So what was the state of mind of India at that time? You will all be surprised to know that till 1940 there was no difference of opinion broadly between the RSS school of thought and the rest of the political, economic, social thinkers of India. This is the first shocking thing I came to know when I studied. And even people outside India, the left thinkers and communists, how they viewed India was not very different from how the RSS viewed India. There is one Hinman report of 1907. It is available on the Marxist Internet Archive even today. You can go and access it. This is what the Hinman report says about India and Hinduism. The rise of the Indian bourgeois. With reference to India's attainment in science, the Hinman report says, those who wish to further into the question of Hindu movement in various directions will find an admirable summary, largely drawn from European statements and admission. In Hindu Superiority by Harbila Sarda, published in English at Ajmer in November 1906. In his laudable anxiety to uphold the reputation of his race in the country, the author says, perhaps somewhat taking an optimist view of the capacity of his own people, but the quotations given and the facts adduced in this book of more than 450 pages ought to silence forever the foolish and ignorant sneers at Hindu inferiority. This is the Marxist view of India in the year 1907. It is not very many years ago, I remember hearing Japanese spoken of with similar lofty contempt by English traders and travelers. Just they talked so lofty contempt with which they spoke about Japan, they talk about India, which is wrong. The Hindu superiority is something which the Marxist establishment accepted in the year 1907. It is called Hinman Report. It is available in the Marxist archives even today. If you talk about it today, if the same Hinman Report is brought into the curriculum of India, they will say it is saffronization of education. Marxist own document. You can understand the dishonesty, the shift, the tectonic shift that has taken place in the opinion making, self-assessment of India, opinion about India, assessment about India, appreciation of India and Hinduism. There is a tectonic change against India. You must have heard about one Rajani Palme Dutt. Rajani Palme Dutt was an Indian who established the Communist Party in England. He was the president of the Communist Party in England. He wrote a book, India Today, in the year 1939. And that book he revised in 1972 before he passed away. In that book, whatever he has said is about India and Hinduism and Hindu people is not very different from what the RSS had said about India, Hinduism. Rajani Palme Dutt was a communist leader who was assessing Hindus. And I am going to read out to you his response to the criticism that it is only because of the English education Indians have begun launching the freedom movement. This is one of the things the British said. These people did not have an idea of freedom at all. It is we who taught them English, they got educated and they came to know how free we are a country, and that is how they got the freedom of spirit. Without English education, without our schools and colleges, the freedom movement in India would not have gotten, because all the people who led the freedom movement were educated Indians. So we created the thirst for freedom in India. This is how the Westerners began to appropriate our freedom movement and say, it is our gift to you, the spirit of freedom, that is why you are. See how Rajani Palme Dutt meets that criticism. The rise of Indian bourgeois against the British bourgeois is inevitable, whatever the system of education. It is not because of the English system of education. The Indian bourgeois, that means the Indian elites, would have definitely risen against the British elite. If the Indian bourgeois were educated only in Sanskrit Vedas, in monastic seclusion from every other current of thought, they would have assuredly found in the Sanskrit Vedas the inspiring principles and slogans for freedom struggle. The Vedas and Upanishads would have given them the thought for freedom and the slogans for the freedom movement. This is a communist leader. This is the major work on pre-colonial India and the freedom of struggle by Indians, written by a communist leader. And this book he revised and re-edited in 1972, but did not remove this para. Then now come to Pandit Nehru, 1934. He wrote a book about glimpses of world history. That was the book he wrote in the year 1934. See what he says about Hindu nationalism. It's not easy to draw a line between Hindu nationalism and true nationalism. The two overlap, as India is the only home of the Hindus, and they overlap each other. This was his view in 1934. That is, it is very difficult to draw a line between Hindu nationalism and true nationalism. That means Hindu nationalism can be regarded as the true nationalism. This is 1934. And now you look at, this is at page 720 of that book, and see what he says in page 1934. You may be surprised why I am mentioning all this. All that Golwalkar struggled in his life was to keep alive the agreed and consensual thought about what is Hindu nationalism after India got freedom, when the very winners of the freedom, very leaders of the freedom movement, the very governors of India began working against what they said about India till 1940. Nehru says in the book at page 507, a famous disciple of Ramakrishna was Swami Vivekananda, who eloquently and forcefully preached the gospel of nationalism. This was not anti-Muslim or anti-anyone. Nonetheless, Vivekananda's nationalism was Hindu nationalism, and it had its roots in Hindu religion and culture. This was Pandit Nehru's view in 1934. You take Mahatma Gandhi. He wrote his Hind Swaraj in 1909. I don't think there is any other book which is intellectually stimulating about the Indian civilization more than Hind Swaraj. Unfortunately, many of us have not read it. We should read it. It is just about 40-45 pages. One of the finest documentation the man wrote in the travel in the ship between Cape Town and London. He wrote it in Gujarati. Somebody is interrogating him. He is the editor. And somebody is interrogating him. This is the question. That is the question in the mind of many people, in the mind of the educated Indians, in the mind of the British, in the mind of the people who want freedom, in the mind of the people who do not want freedom for India. All these questions he had formulated in his mind, and then he began asking the questions himself and then writing down the answers. And he began writing in the travel between Cape Town and London. And when he was so tired and his right hand was paining, he started writing by the left hand. He never stopped writing. It was an inspired document. In the document, two questions arose. One question is, who are you? You are never one nation. Why I am mentioning all this is, this completely, all these thoughts converge with the thoughts of Golwalkar. That's why I am saying all this. One question that was asked to Mahatma Gandhi was, you are never one nation. It is we British who brought the railways and the post office and made you into one nation. Otherwise, where were you? You had no unity. Then Gandhiji said, it's a beautiful answer. He said, our forefathers knew, and our religion says, that you could worship God in your own home and even in yourself. Still, our forefathers established these diverse kshetras and tirthas. and made us travel in millions from one place to the other. And we had no language commonalities, but still we could converse with each other, go to each place, revere the local deities, and by making us mobile all over, despite all the diversities, he made us to feel that we are one nation. And he said that you could create one government, one post office, one railway, because we were one nation already. You must read that document simply because the beauty of the ideas, the language, the conviction. Because many of us ignore Mahatma Gandhi, which is completely wrong. He is one of the greatest Hindus to be born in this country. You always have disagreements with people. We always have differences with people. But fundamentally, you cannot find a more articulate, capable, logical, rational, acceptable leader than Mahatma Gandhi. I have read a lot about him. In fact, his quotes have been cited to me by Kanchi Mahaswami and Ramnath Goenka to give a direction to my life, which has completely changed me and shaped me and directed me. Another question that was put to him: all that you are saying is only about Hindus, but what about Muslims? Muslims have come to India. And how are you going to handle the Muslim problem? For which his answer was, you see, Muslims have come, no doubt, but that does not make this country any different than one nation. You may ask how. You see, we have digested and assimilated all the people who have come into India, and we will assimilate the Muslims also. And unless we have the power and capacity of assimilation, we cannot call ourselves one nation. Assimilation. This is the Guruji formula for India as one nation. Power of assimilation of people. Mahatma Gandhi spoke about the power of assimilation. So you see, whether it is Gandhi, whether it is communist, whether it is Jawaharlal Nehru, till 1940, there has been a broad convergence of opinion about the Hindu identity of India. Unassailable. Nobody can dispute. Nobody can rewrite, because these are all settled facts. Everything changes once the Muslim League passes the resolution for creation of Pakistan. That is what completely unsettled the Indian mind. We did not know how to handle this situation. I don't want to take you more into this, because it is a complex story of politics, religion, external forces like the Westerners, and many other forces. Our own mistakes in 1923 by externalizing the mind of the Muslims from India to Caliphate. All this combined to produce a combustible kind of situation between 1941 and what led to the partition of India in 1947. But in this, the whole political discourse changed. The change in the discourse was that the identity of Hindus are India's identity with Hindu, the philosophy of Hindus, or the culture of Hinduism, is not something which is wholesome. This is sectional. This is only one side of India. This thought came only after 1940. It was never there earlier. Whether it is the communists or the Congress or Sangam, there was convergence about the Hindu identity of India. This completely changed in the period when Golwalkar took over the leadership of the RSS. The most important thing is, when the convergence was there, Golwalkar was not leading the RSS. When the divergence was there, Guruji Golwalkar led the RSS. See, his tremendous responsibility to keep alive the pre-1940 convergence of the Indian nation about the Hindu identity, Hindu past, Hindu culture, Hindu value systems, Hindu heritage, Hindu ancestry. Everything was distorted in 10 years. This is the period in which Guruji takes over the leadership of the RSS, which stands for what this nation stood for till 1940. This is the most important thing. It is not that RSS created a new thought. RSS created a new model of working. But it was a broadly accepted consensus on which the RSS and Guruji began working to restore the ancient unity of India, which transcended all the invaders, which transcended the Muslim conquest, which transcended colonization, which made Mahatma Gandhi to say that if we are one, we were one, and that is why they could create one government, which made Jawaharlal Nehru say it is not possible to distinguish between Hindu nationalism and Indian nationalism, which made a communist like Rajani Palme Dutt to say that hell with you, we would have found our identity, our philosophy, our slogans for freedom through the Vedas and the teaching of Sanskrit. This was the consensus. In fact, I find a little fault with many thinkers in RSS who think that the RSS created the idea of Hindu nation. Not at all. The RSS asserted the idea of Hindu nationalism. RSS did not create the idea of Hindu nation or Hindu nationalism. We became the chief campaigners for it because others deserted it. Because others deserted this idea for political reasons, we became the chief defendants. That does not mean we are the owners. We are not the owners of the idea of Hindu nation. We are the defenders of the idea of Hindu nation. Once we know this, then we will be able to convince the people that you fellows were also thinking like this till 1940. You people defected. We have stood. Once this formulation is there, the capacity of people who talk against you will be reduced to impotency. Added to that was the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi, a crisis which could not have been handled by anybody other than a person like Golwalkar. Everyone knew RSS had nothing to do with it, but the political system saw in it an opportunity to finish the RSS. And for 1 year, this campaign was there. RSS was involved in the murder, which even today the political system echoes for its own reasons, in spite of the fact, all the facts prove, all the inquiries prove, all the cases and documentation prove that the RSS had nothing to do with it. But it was in this period, the whole idea of Hindu nationalism, Hindu Rashtra, Hindu culture, Hindu identity, came to be regarded as something which is burdensome. And of course, modernity also began to paint Hinduism as a backward religion, as not fit for modern life, as something which has to be discarded. And there were reasons, researches, Western orientation to this thought which the English educated people of not only India but the entire world accepted. This was based on what is known as the methodological individualist principles, which improves the sociology all over the world, including in India. And India became the biggest victim because of its familiarity with English. Because of English, we could very easily import these ideas, internalize it, begin abusing us ourselves. You know, this did not happen by accident, it happened by design. If you have to develop economically, you have to be like us. This is what the West said. It didn't say by just some scholar saying it, or some leader saying it, or some political party saying it, or by some country saying it. This was said by none other than the United Nations in the year 1951. And this was called the modern Western anthropological model of development. In fact, many economists in India have also not studied it in depth. The entire market principles, efficient market principle, everything is founded on what is known as the Western modern anthropology. The United Nations said in the year 1951, as an advisory to the underdeveloped nations — underdeveloped nations mean all nations other than America and Europe — it said, I have not brought the quote here, but I have to quote for you to understand. There is a sense in which economic development is not possible unless a society gives up its philosophy, its lifestyle, its relations and value systems. Unless a society does this, it will not be able to develop. And those who want to develop will have to give up all their ancient philosophies. And if you don't want to give up, you have got to suffer under development. Quote unquote, this was the advisory of the United Nations. So all this became the ruling thoughts in our universities, in our academics, in our researchers, in our sociology departments, in our economic policy making. Unless you discard all that is your own, you will never be able to develop. That's how the Indian planning, Indian economic thinking, Indian economic thinkers, Indian intellectuals, Indian media, they all began working towards de-Indianizing India, de-Hinduizing India. It happened by a design. And it is supposed to be all can develop only by following the Western model. Why I am mentioning it is, apart from cultural philosophical reasons, for political and economic reasons also, the RSS had to wage a huge war under the leadership of Golwalkar in the 1950s, 60s and early 70s. It is an unbelievable intellectual, political and moral battle, in which Golwalkar was never arrested by the context. He never looked at what is the present context, how to get out of it, should I say something to get out of it. He never was arrested by the context. He was the greatest dissenter to the direction in which this country was being led by the great leaders of India. And he did it with the highest dignity. That is the most important thing. Those who are lawyers here will understand what is dissent in judiciary. There are 5 judges, 4 judges on the one side. The 5th judge gives a dissenting note. You know, in law it is not valid. 4 judges, those who give the judgment, only their judgment is valid. But why does this one judge feel that he has to write a dissenting judgment which has no value at all? Nobody is going to cite it. Nobody is going to read it. Why does he do it? When the entire establishment is driving in one direction, why does this single man feel, no, I am different, what these people are doing doesn't seem to be correct, and I have to state my views? He doesn't feel that 4 people are on the one side, why should I write something and get into unpopularity? I can also become part of the 5th. No. There is a philosophy of dissent. The philosophy of social and cultural descent of Guruji is clearly comparable to the philosophy of judicial descent. Why does a judge who disagrees with his brother judges, who constitute the majority in a judgment, his views do not constitute law or precedent, still he writes a dissenting judgment? When a judge in a minority dissents to the judgment which is being delivered by the majority of his colleague, that what he says may have no relevance at the time when he delivers the judgment. The minority judgment is delivered today, it has no value at all. It is philosophically regarded as a moral appeal to the future. This is the most important thing. I am appealing to the future. What is the appeal? The best description of what is the philosophy of dissent in the judiciary comes from Justice Charles Hughes, who served on the American Supreme Court from 1910 to 1916, left the bench to run for president, and then returned to the court as Chief Justice from 1930 to 1941. This is the person who gave the philosophy of what is a dissenting judgment, which exactly applies to Guruji's dissent against the popular opinion, settled opinion, led by powerful leaders, establishment, supported by the world, modernity. Guruji was the sole dissent. Why did he dissent? Justice Hughes wrote, "A dissent is an appeal to the brooding spirit of law, to the intelligence of the future day, when a later decision may probably correct the error into which the dissenting judge believes the court has been betrayed into." See how beautifully put. The majority has been betrayed into a wrong judgment, and I am appealing to the future intelligence of the people and this court that they may correct it. And that is why I write it. This was the struggle of Guruji. His stand was moral. His appeal was moral. He sought for in the future morality of the people, power of his idea, purity of his thought. Otherwise, he had no reason to carry on this huge, unbelievably powerful enemy being taken on with a branding that this organization was involved in killing Mahatma Gandhi. It was not a thought-to-thought competition. It was that you have been described as unacceptable. See the disadvantage, double disadvantage. As an idea, you are working against the most powerful thought current, establishment thought current of India, supported by global forces, global economic thinking, global establishments on the one side. On the other side, you have been branded as this. This was the position in which Guruji was leading. And you know, the most important facet of a great man who is a seer is not how he is regarded in his own times, how his thoughts were in his own times. It is how he is regarded afterwards and how his thoughts became valid after him. The most important test of a person's thoughts is whether his thoughts survived him and became powerful after him. This is the Indian tradition. Whether it is Shankaracharya or Madhvacharya or Kabir or anyone, in their own times, whether they were that influential as they are today is a question mark. Many people may not have heard about the fundamentalism project of the Chicago University. Have you heard? In the year 1990, the Chicago University and the American Institute of Sociology constituted a study as to what is religious fundamentalism. And they analyzed the thought currents of different religions, including Hinduism, Christianity, Islam, and different institutions, including the RSS. It is a 5-volume project, probably the only project of that kind, in which RSS figures out of some 2000 pages or 3000 pages, the RSS figures in some 300 or 350 pages. The fundamentalism project, you will be stunned to know, endorses the view of Guruji about Hinduism, Hindu Rashtra, Hindu cultural nationalism. Guruji said, whenever they used to talk about RSS, they used to say it is a Hindu revivalist organization. Guruji said this term revival doesn't apply to Hinduism. They used to say it is a reactionary organization. Guruji said the word reaction doesn't apply, because we have nobody to react to. We are an all-inclusive organization. We accept all the faiths. We don't react to anyone. Others may react, but we don't react to anyone. And these are inappropriate to describe Hinduism. You read the bunch of thoughts, all this comes. This is, I'll tell you exactly which para. I have quoted all of this in the book. I don't want to give the details, but all these details are available. And he says state and nation are different. It's very peculiar in India. In all other countries, the state created the nation. Here the nation existed without a state. This nation existed with a hostile state. And Guruji used to say how nation is a state of mind, a belief, a love, an idea of oneness, which can last for 2000 years without a state. He mentioned the Jewish nation, which did not have Israel for a piece of territory, also was not available. There was no state, but it lived in the mind of the Jews. Guruji said, nation lives in the mind and the heart of the people and unites them. A state is an independent thing. You know, these are all things which the West could not understand, because when the French nation was created, only 2% of the French people spoke the French language. The others were beaten into the French nation. The same is the case with Italy. All the nations in Europe was created by marriages, concubinage, and killing. I mean, this is how nations were created. They were not nations. Eric Hobsbawm, who is probably the most authoritative writer on nation and nationalism, he was a Marxist scholar, he said the idea of nation state that is there in the West today was originated in the 18th and 19th centuries and not earlier. Now many people ask, you know, when did India come into being? When did the Hindu nation come into being? It is all 1947. It is in Garuda Purana. Garuda Purana describes what is Bharatavarsha. What are the territories? What are the adjoining people? It is in Brahmanda Purana. It is in Bhagavata Purana. All these are old, according to the current calculation, at least 1700 years. And it says that the people who reside in this territory are called Bharatiyas. And they are a mysterious kind of people. So even 1700 years before, we were mysterious, and we remain mysterious even today, because it is impossible to bring us into a definition, because the diversity amongst us is so vast. If you put India on the one side and the rest of the world on the other, you will see more diversity in India than the rest of the world put together. We have language diversities, we have look diversities, we have natural diversities. The diversity is both natural and in terms of human pursuits. And this kind of diversity is an unmanageable diversity. And to find unity in it, you need a philosophy which has to comprehend the whole humanity. Unless you have a philosophy which could comprehend the whole humanity, you cannot find that philosophy uniting India. We had 33 crore gods. The number of gods were more than the number of Hindus at one point. In fact, we all laugh at it. We can laugh at our own god also. We have beaten our god. You know, in Tamil Nadu, there is an incident in which God was beaten up in Madurai. Shiva was beaten black and blue. This is a religious text which is read in all Shiva temples. We can play with our God. We can abuse our God. I have seen many bhaktas saying, "What are you doing? You are doing nothing for me. You are not even a human being." I have seen people abusing even in an unacceptable language, because that is the way they endear themselves to their gods. Arun Shori told me an incident of a conversation between Bhai Mohan Singh and Zail Singh. And Zail Singh was the president of India and Bhai Mohan Singh was a big industrialist. So you know, the Sikhs created a religion in which Murti Puja was not to be accepted. But you know, ultimately we need some symbol. So what they did, Guru Granth Sahib is the symbol. Then they put Guru Granth Sahib in plastic bag and then began doing Abhishekam further. And it was like it became like an idol. And then they built a separate room for that. And in every house you will find a room for Guru Granth Sahib. So Arun Shori related this incident beautifully in a meeting in Chennai and said, how we can laugh at our God, criticize our God, endear ourselves to our gods are not terrifying gods, we will finish you. It is not that. Our gods are loving gods. That is why our gods have been able to survive, you must understand. So Shori said, Bhai Mohan Singh told Zail Singh, हमने ग्रंथ साहब के लिए एक नया रूम बनाया है, उसमें इटालियन मार्बल लगाया है, एक बाथरूम भी बनाया है ग्रंथ साहब के लिए, और कोई नहीं जाना है उधर, ग्रंथ साहब के लिए यह बनाया है। सो जेल सिंह आस्टिंग, उसमें इंडियन क्लासेट लगाया, वेस्टर्न क्लासेट लगाया, द होल ऑडियंस रोर, ही सेड वी कैन डील विद अवर गॉड्स लाइक दिस। There is one Jean-Pierre Lemon, who is the IMD professor and became the advisor to the WTO, who wrote an article in the year 2006 in the Globalist magazine as to what makes Hinduism different and how is it ticking in modern times. He said, the greatest quality of Hinduism is that it makes you worship more than one God. It is the single God religions which are a problem. More than one God, naturally you are tolerant. And if you have thousands of gods, he has one God, I have one God, he has one God, in one house itself there are several gods. So you cannot say this God is bad or that God is bad. So he said, this quality of worshipping multiple gods and still finding unity is the greatest idea of Hindu philosophy. Hindu philosophy is able to unite everything. And you can go on and on. You know, in the life of Ramanujacharya, there is an incident. He goes to the Puri temple. You know, wherever he goes, he prescribes the Pancharatra method of worship. Pancharatra method of worship is the ideal method of worship, and he was suggesting it to all the disciples. So when he went to Puri, he said about, in Puri, the method of worship was some tribal method of worship. So he said, no, you should stop it tomorrow, tomorrow onwards you should adopt the Pancharatra method of worship. Then all the disciples went to Jagannatha and said, for thousands of years we have been worshipping you like this. Our guru says we have to change. What will we do? We have no heart to change. Ramanuja's life story says, Jagannatha came in the dream of Ramanuja and said, please don't stand between me and my worshippers. Even today, the method of worship that is followed in Puri is only the tribal method of worship. This was the extent of religious freedom in India. The guru cannot impose a method of worship on the disciple. This is the diversity. So, Guruji explained all this and said there cannot be reaction, there is no communalism, there is no exclusion. All this he was saying repeatedly in lecture after lecture after lecture. The fundamentalism project says exactly what Guruji says. It says that the idea of militant Hinduism, religious revivalism, reactionary Hinduism are inappropriate to describe Hinduism. Who says this? Fundamentalism project of Chicago University. Guruji said this 40 years back. That global endorsement comes for Guruji 40 years later by scholars unconnected to us, by process unconnected to us, by nation unconnected to us, shows the power of Guruji's thought. Then comes the Supreme Court judgment. I don't know how many of you had occasion to read the Hindutva judgment of the Supreme Court. You read the Hindutva judgment of the Supreme Court and bunch of thoughts. Every word has been taken from bunch of thoughts without quoting Guruji. Because they do not know Guruji. Guruji says Hinduism is anadi. Supreme Court says Hinduism is without a beginning. Like this you can say everything. He says it is a way of life of the people of this country. Supreme Court said it is a way of life of the people of this country. Guruji says you cannot reduce it to a religion. Supreme Court says you cannot regard it as a religion. It is the culture of the people of India. He said it is the culture of the people of India. Indianization is to make the people think that this country, our forefathers are one. Indianization is not something communal. It is an integrating idea, the Supreme Court says. Without referring to Guruji, this is the most important thing. The power of the philosopher's idea was so truthful that in a contestual litigation, the Supreme Court comes to the same conclusion. If there had been a debate with Guruji, the same thing would have happened. There was no debate with Guruji. There was only a monologue abuse against him. The man still never gave up his patience. Never even gave up his respect for the opponent. I will give you two instances. You know, many people wanted to show black flags to Pandit Nehru in London. Pandit Nehru had sworn not to give an inch of land for the Bhagwa to fly. He said, I'll finish the RSS. This was Guruji. This was Jawaharlal. When black flags were shown to Jawaharlal in London, somebody asked in the media, Guruji. Guruji said, no, this is wrong. We have our differences, but in front of the third party, he quoted that famous Mahabharata sloka, Vayam Panchatikam Shatam. He is our prime minister and no one has the right to humiliate him. This is a very well-known incident. Another not so well-known incident took place in Jaipur, where some swayamsevaks were talking very casually about Pandit Nehru, criticizing him. Guruji had just then gone to rest. He came out and asked, who spoke like this? Then the Swayamsevaks began shivering. He said, never he spoke like this. Do you have the qualification to comment on such a great man like this? He's the Prime Minister of India. He commands the respect of the largest section of the Indian people. You talk like this? You should never talk like this. It is a private talk. It is not for public consumption. He wants this organization to develop these qualities. And I am told Guruji was so disturbed, he did not sleep that afternoon. Genuinely disturbed. This is the person. That is why his thoughts were powerful, truthful, accepted. And this goes on. He said dharma and religion are different. Our constitution itself says both are one. Dharma nirapekshata. The Supreme Court is bound by the Constitution of India. It could not say dharma is different from religion. Ultimately, the Supreme Court held dharma and religion are not the same. Completely endorsing Guruji. There is a convergence between Guruji, Supreme Court, and fundamentalism project. The RSS current thought has been endorsed about the nation, about cultural nationalism, about Indianization, about how Hinduism is not opposed to secularism, how Hinduism accommodates all religions, how we have never treated any person differently because he worships another god or another follows another way of life. These were all the philosophical premises on which the RSS idea of Hindu nation was founded. Completely endorsed by the Supreme Court and by the fundamentalism project. And Guruji stood for minority assimilation. His assimilation principle was very simple. He said, these Muslims and Christians did not come from outside. They belong to India. Our forefathers and the forefathers of Hindus are one and the same. This thought is sufficient to unite India. This is what he said. Unity of India does not mean you hold each other's hand and stand. That we are the descendants of the same forefathers, this thought is sufficient to unite India. The simplest formula one could have given for the unity of India. It is not Hindu-Muslim unity. It is the unity of all persons born in this country. This was Guruji's exposition, in which he said, the Muslim being made to realize that he is part of the same ancestry is assimilation. This was the assimilation which Gandhiji spoke about. This is precisely the assimilation which Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru also spoke about. There was no divergence between Pandit Nehru, Jawaharlal Nehru and Gandhi with Guruji on assimilation. But today assimilation is a bad word because we have not been able to explain to those who say assimilation is a bad word. But this is the word Mahatma Gandhi and Pandit Nehru have also used because we don't also study. We need to study. We need to equip ourselves because it is a philosophical war. I do not use the word ideology because Guruji never used the word ideology throughout his discourse in Bunch of Thoughts. He used the word only philosophy. In fact, I was surprised because in 2006 only the difference between philosophy and ideology came. And surprisingly, this originated in a discourse in America led by none other than Bill Clinton. Was neither a philosopher nor a sociologist. He was just an American president. He said, in ideology, a person believes he is right, the other person is wrong. In philosophy, a person thinks he is right and maybe the other person is also right. There is a possibility of a dialogue in a philosophy and there is no possibility of a dialogue in ideology. Ideology was born out of the Abrahamic religions which believe they are right and others are wrong. The word ideology came essentially in French Revolution and later in the communist thinking. It was never part of the Indian system. When this 2006 divergence came, I looked at the bunch of thoughts. In 27 places, Guruji has described Hinduism only as a philosophy. The word ideology has not been used at all. This is one of the things which we should know. It is only in describing what is written in that book, somebody has said about RSS ideology. Otherwise, it was always RSS philosophy. See the words he has chosen. He never used a word which is not in tune with the Hindu thinking. Ideology is not a word with in tune with Hindu thinking. Philosophy is. Then Guruji said there is nothing called multiculturalism, there is nothing called composite culture. There has to be a core culture to which other cultures, even if there is a cultural diversity, must be aligned. Guruji was completely alone in the whole world. The whole world was celebrating multiculturalism. Multiculturalism is the basis of democracy and diversity. This is how the world was discussing. In the last 20 years, the whole West has changed. Huntington has said multiculturalism will destroy the West. Guruji said composite culture will disintegrate India. A core culture is needed. The core culture idea which is being discussed in the West is what Guruji discussed in 1950s and 60s in India. None of us study all this. It's very important for us to do cross-cultural studies. Taking Guruji as a sum total personality who guided not only the RSS but also the nation in the most critical times. The power of the man was so great and his purity was so unassailable. When at the height of anti-RSS ecosystem, when Guruji passed away, the parliament paid a tribute to Guruji. And the person who led the debate was none other than the person who had the greatest difference of opinion with Guruji, that is Indira Gandhi herself. This is the power of Guruji. His relevance is that all that he conceptualized, theorized, spoke, and shaped not only the RSS but the country has been endorsed by subsequent events. That is the most important thing. He was not arrested by the context and said, no, today the situation is bad, let me use a different language. Not at all. He was consistent and he was a rishi. I'll give you two instances apart from all this. In the final session he was taking, his last session, a question was asked about China. What about China? And what about Pakistan? And he answers, I want to read out that to you. This dialogue took place in the year 1972 when China was deep in perpetual revolution agenda of Mao Zedong. It was reeling under the impact of Cultural Revolution of 1965, which was its endeavor to disconnect itself from all traditions. Millions of Redguards were let into the streets. They were encouraged to destroy. Four worlds: old customs, old habits, old culture, old thinking. And in the process, damaged many of China's temples, valuable work of art and buildings. The Red Guards were instructed to treat the Cultural Revolution as a class struggle, in which everything which does not fit the socialist system and proletarian dictators should be attacked. The Cultural Revolution was turned into a civil war and chaos. The revolution became less intense from 1971, officially ended when the Gang of Four, including Mao Zedong, who led the revolution, was arrested on October 6, 1976. It was at that time Guruji was asked, what will be the future of China? Guruji said, a Confucian China will emerge out of the communist China. You know, today, the greatest effort of China is to reinstate Confucius. They have opened over 300 Confucian centers all over the world. And Guruji added, a Confucian China will emerge out of the communist China with its empire-building instincts intact. See the vision. He could see decades before how China will have this empire-building instinct. Today we are seeing it. The whole world is worried about the rise of China, not economically, but with its empire building intact. And then they were asked about, he was asked about Pakistan. He said it will be a permanent irritant for the world. You know, these are all not normal statements. These are not supported by logical reasoning. This is supported by intuitive vision. So I have broadly given how Golwalkar is a contemporary thought. It is not a thought of 30, 40 years before. He is relevant even today, but the way we present Golwalkar is important for the nation to understand him and also the world to understand him. Otherwise, the past ideas which have been implanted through decades and decades of campaign against the RSS will persist, and we have a huge responsibility to exorcise the public opinion and the opinion making and the bias and prejudice that the society has by our study of the whole thing. We don't study, the fault is ours, and so we don't fully grasp the contemporaneousness of Golwalkar. And the responsibility is on all who want this nation to grow and provide leadership to the world. In the year 2030, the National Intelligence Council of America, which is the think tank attached to the Central Intelligence Agency, says that there will be only three major world powers in 2030. And all the powers which are calling themselves as global powers will become regional chieftains. And there will be only three major world powers. That is America, China, and India. What is it that we are going to tell the world as a leader? We have developed only the followers mentality so far. We have to develop the leadership mentality. We have to tell what the world needs. The world needs more than at any point in time a non-conflicting philosophy which has originated only in this country. And that has been brilliantly, intuitively, with foresight, articulated by Guruji. And we owe it to him and to this organization and to this nation to expound this, write about it, talk about it, study it in depth. And this is my appeal to all of you. Thank you very much.
Friends, I think many words come to mind when we want to react to such an astounding speech, truly thought-provoking, and I would like to now invite Dr. Giridhar Upadhyaya to deliver the vote of thanks and also present this book to Sri Gurumurti ji as our token of appreciation.
Karyakramada konaya bhagakke bandideve. It's a privilege to propose the vote of thanks to our distinguished speaker. I extend my heartfelt thanks to Sri Gurumurthy, distinguished speaker for the day, on behalf of Manthana, for having accepted our invitation and rendering an insightful talk on Guruji and contemporary India. Thank you very much, sir. My heartfelt thanks to managing committee members of the Rashtriya Vidyalaya Trust for allowing us to use this beautiful and fully equipped conventional hall. My sincere thanks to distinguished guests who have spent their valuable time to grace this occasion. Many thanks to our friends from the press and the media for covering this event. My heartfelt thanks to all the invitees for making this occasion a grand success. Last but not the least, special thanks to the staff of NMKRV College Shashwati Hall who have worked and hard towards making this event successful. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Just one last announcement. This coming Sunday, there will be Shraddhanjali to pay tributes to our senior Pracharak who passed away recently, Manya Shri Maicha Jayadev. It will be held in the Mythic Society. Thank you. Thank you all.
What time?
11 o'clock, 11 a.m.
Second right.
Hard to